Thanks again for being here, for taking the time and being part, actually, to end up our speaker series for the year on a high note. Just wanted to start out by asking if you could tell us a little bit about your path. You know, Dr. Singh's talked some of the specific points, but could you talk more from your lens, how that career path is going, maybe some standout moment to share?
Sure. Try to make a long story short. I'm a local guy, south side of Milwaukee, and went to Greenfield High School in Whitewater and Cardinal Stritch, and got my master's here in 93. Worked at Lattice as a buyer right out of college, got laid off right away. Talking about hurdles, that was one of the biggest things. You come out of college, you get a job finally, and you get laid off right away. So that was a big hurdle. What do I do now? Took a job at a wire cable company and bought wire and sold wire, and worked my way up, purchasing, inside sales, outside sales, national sales manager. Worked up to the board of directors, and another big hurdle came, and they hired someone from outside, and I had worked at this company a long time, and they hired someone else to be vice president. And I was too young and to sit back, and a lot of people said, oh, you should have been vice president. So that's where Cardinal Stritch really came in handy, and got my master's here, and they helped me with a business plan. And I found two rich guys to borrow me money, and started my own company, and was able to buy them out in time. So that was another big hurdle, how do you overcome that? From that, it was touched on that I was lucky and sold my business. Someone offered me twice what it was worth in September of 08 when everything was crashing. And everyone thinks I'm a genius, and not I was lucky. I didn't know that we were gonna go into recession, some call it depression. But, and that gave me the resources and opportunities to do other things in the community. I was touched on about the Milwaukee Wave. The Milwaukee Wave actually was out of business, the longest running soccer franchise in Milwaukee. And I was able to save that and help and had a lot of fun with that. We won two championships. I got one of the rings on now. We were in the playoffs all 4 years. It was a lot of fun to be involved with a professional sports organization. And then from there, next level, J.J. Watts. Some of you know J.J. Watts from the area. He works out there. Got into sports performance. I do small business consulting. I buy and sell some commercial and residential property. And currently, I'm involved with Legends of the Field Sports Memorabilia, where I'm dealing with professional athletes, selling autographs, selling canvases, selling sports items to the public. So been involved a little bit at everything. Kind of bounced around, and we were kidding earlier, I'm not sure what I want to do when I grow up, so I keep trying different things.
So thanks for the overview. And one piece along the way you mentioned, and we're here at Stritch, so I'm compelled to ask the impact that your Stritch education had on that trajectory, and I know your capstone you briefly mentioned was particularly important. Maybe you can speak about that.
Sure. Actually, I'm very proud of speaking of that because that business plan really set the path for me and saved me in a lot of ways. When I was going for my master's and got through the classes and you have to develop the business plan, I didn't quite understand why the three professors were so tough on me and beating me up on it. And I'm like, I just want to get done. I want to get out of here. You know, but they kept beating me up, and it was great because I developed a tremendous business plan. And when it came in handy, when I needed to buy out the two partners, and I went to the bank, and the bank said, you know, we just don't borrow new businesses or, you know, money. But they took a look at the business plan, and they're like, this is one of the best business plans I've ever seen out there. So at that time, I was very thankful that those three Cardinal Stritch professors beat me up pretty good. I didn't understand it at the time, but it came in very handy. And I used that business plan constantly, revising it with my employees, sitting down at least once a year, usually twice a year, sitting in a room like this and saying, let's perfect this business plan. Let's change this business plan. How do we grow? How do we improve this business? So that was really the model, the floor plan that I use and constantly use to make world-class wire and cable so successful.
I see the instructors, they're happy that you're talking about.
Yeah, I look, you know, it's none of them that beat me up.
A Franciscan beating up, though, I'm sure. Okay, good. And then from there, so if we fast forward to now, your time in running businesses these last several years, the various companies, one of the focal points of this speaker series is how do you align your business decisions with your values? And how do you infuse the values within these different businesses? Could you talk about practical ways you do that?
Sure. Some of you that may have heard me speak before, I stress 25 core values, and we don't have time to go through them all today, but a lot of them were developed here from Cardinal Stritch, and I understand they might be handed out. And when you look at them, they're very simple things, and most of you will look at it and say, I know that, you know, be honest, be nice to people, respect others, help others, volunteer in the community. But a lot of those were developed here at Cardinal Stritch, which I don't think anyone can argue with anything on that list.
I'm curious, along those lines, if you can think of a particular instance in one of your businesses where you felt you had a big decision to make and those values came to the fore, impacting the way you were proceeding.
Yeah, I don't know about the tough decision, but a couple that stand out is, you know, taking ownership. You know you have a successful business or organization or team when everyone takes ownership in that business or in that organization. So people always make fun of me, but when I do small business consulting and I walk around, I always ask for a tour, and I demand that I go into the warehouse, and I demand that I go into the bathrooms. And it seems silly, but when I go into a bathroom and I see the bathroom dirty, or I see the toilet roll empty, or I see in the warehouse paper clips or pennies thrown on the ground, I know I have a problem there in employees not taking ownership of the company. Because a good organization, every employee cares about that company and keeps it clean and keeps it organized. So that sounds kind of silly, but when you have every employee in an organization take ownership, you know you have a successful business.
In addition to showing that care in the business, I think one of the things you told me earlier is you take a lot of pride in taking care in the community, your civic engagement, which we had a slide up earlier of so many things you're involved in. Talk a little bit about why that's become a priority for you, and if there's a particular cause or an area you're involved in, maybe you'd like to speak about.
Sure. A lot of times when you're working in a business, everyone is so concerned about the bottom line that you just concentrate on the profits of the company. But what I found is, you know, you want to have fun also, and you want your employees to be well motivated. So I constantly encourage, whether it's a business I buy or consult, I tell them to make their employees members of a sports team, whatever it is, volunteer in the community. And it helps in a lot of ways. One, you gain experience, you're networking with people, you're building your network, which is huge to have a good network. You're learning, you're doing things and learning something, and you're getting experience. So for me as a business owner, someone is teaching my employee a skill that maybe I can't teach, or I never thought of. Or maybe they volunteer for something they really like that they don't do at my company. But they're gathering experience. And also important, they feel good about themselves. They're helping someone else. Those people help them back. So I strongly recommend, whether it's, again, volunteering at the church, coaching a youth team. There's a million nonprofits here in Milwaukee and southeastern Wisconsin, and they're all good. And I just encourage people, find something that you have a passion for, something you want to go help. And everyone always thinks money, and it's not money. Money is nice, but they need people volunteering their time, their hours. And all these organizations are dying for volunteers. So I strongly recommend that people get out there and do it. And it comes back. It comes back to you.
So transitioning from, so now you're here and you've had these great successes, but it wasn't so long ago, as you pointed out to me, when you were struggling and trying to get the investors and trying to make that business plan work. So for those who, let me ask a question first of all that you might find this interesting. how many people are interested in, or about to, are interested in starting their own business, let's say in the next 1 to 3 years? And so, this table wants to start like 5 more businesses. It's a group of entrepreneurs here. So, at that point, so we have a whole bunch of people who are interested in the not too distant future, or in the process of starting their businesses. What guidance could you give? What's the key things they should be thinking about right now?
Well, the one I touched on, ownership, getting every employee to, you know, buy into your company, your concept, include them in the decisions, include them in the business plan, go over the financials with them every single month. I know there's a lot of business people in this room too, and we all love Shark Tank, and we all love to watch that, and we learn a lot from that. There's a show, the fella is actually from Marquette University, and I don't know how many of you seen the show The Profit. Usually follow Shark Tank, but it's a guy who invests in businesses. And 3 of the things that he stresses every single show is the 3 P's: people, process, and product. You gotta have good people to make an organization, a team successful. You gotta have a good product, and you gotta have a process. Maybe the inventory on the system, good flow of paperwork, whatever it is, but you gotta have a process, and you remember those 3 P's. So one of the things now, again, when I go into companies, I always look at, do they have good people, do they have a good process, and do they have a good product? And when you got all 3 of those going, you know, you're very, very successful.
So even when you're successful, you don't get a lot of rest running businesses often. And so for you, is there something in particular now or that you can speak to that keeps you up at night as you're running businesses? What's the thing that, man, you're just trying to figure out how to make it right?
Yeah, well, as I'm going around consulting people too, and we touched on this earlier in the day, people forget a very simple, and I try to keep things simple. People make things so complicated in today's world, and things don't need to be that complicated. But the simple thing, revenue must exceed overhead. And everyone, you know, smiles and says, well, of course we know that. Well, business people don't always practice that. People don't look at their financials monthly. They don't check and see. Everyone wants to go out and buy the best furniture, and they want to go out and buy a nice car, and they want to do everything. It's like, whoa, 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 you know, is your revenue exceeding your overhead every month? Slow down and grow with the company slowly and cautiously. But that very simple rule of revenue must exceed overhead. And I can't sleep sometimes consulting people, and they don't even know if they're making money. Some people, they don't even have financials for the year. And you look at them, and they're like, we're doing great. I'm like, how do you know? You don't even have financials, or you haven't even looked at your financials. So revenue must exceed overhead, I think, kind of explains it all. Not that you're going to do it every single month, not that you're going to do it every year, but you better know that where you're at so that you can move forward and run your company.
And then how about the flip side of that? So that's what keeps you up. What keeps your drive so strong? What fuels your passion to keep going with these businesses? You know, you had such great success when you sold your largest company at just the right time, but you're still going at it strong.
I like the small businesses. I like the underdog. Some people in this room kind of know my history, but I was raised, you know, in a 2-bedroom apartment my whole life, my brother, sister, and I, and had no money, you know, basically the whole life. So I love the underdog. When I coach sports, I like to find a team that's not too talented. I usually take the team that's not talented, and I like to take it to another level. So I get satisfaction on trying to find a way to accomplish something. To the small business that's struggling, how do you help them? How do you turn them around? How do you make them successful? You know, a kid who maybe doesn't have respect in himself or has some issues at home, whatever it is, there's good in everyone, there's good in everything, and find the good and stress that good. And I believe so much of it is right here. It's all mental. We all have issues, we all have problems. How do you overcome them? Anytime you think you got it bad, someone else has it worse. So don't dwell on the negative. Always think the glass is half full. Figure out how to get it done. How do you get results? How do you get to where you want to get? And it's okay if you're failing. Just keep, you keep trying, and you'll get there. And then learn from your past mistakes and move forward. So I've always liked that. I love the movie Rocky. I've seen it probably 200 times.
That's great. Thank you. I want to ask you one more question, and then I'm going to open it up to everybody. So maybe a third of the room, or whatever it was, said they want to start their own business. We got a lot of folks who are working for other businesses and other organizations. Maybe they want to work for one of yours. So if they were to come to you, so you said optimism, clearly you're looking for some of that. A Stritch degree, clearly you're looking for that. And third, what else should they know if they want to work with you?
When people come in, what I look for is, everyone's got the resume, and that's good. And maybe not all resumes are accurate. Everyone embellishes a little bit on their resume, and that's good. But when you come in, I want to see that you have enthusiasm, that you carry yourself well. You have to be confident. To me, it really doesn't matter what your degree in. If you went to college and you took extra classes, maybe it was just a seminar, you're trying to learn. You're trying to better yourself. And I want to see that drive. I want to see that hunger. I want to see that you're willing to learn. And you don't have to speak a lot, but you should be able to present yourself. Because if you're going to be successful in anything you do, you have to have confidence in yourself. In the business, you got to have confidence in the business. You got to have confidence in the product. And you got to have confidence in yourself. And when you say the word salesperson, some people don't like that. But everyone in this room is a salesperson to some degree. And you have to be able to sell yourself in life. Again, you go back to the partner. You're selling yourself to the significant other to date them. You're always selling yourself. You go to the bank for money. Whatever it is, you're buying a car, you negotiate for a car. You're always selling yourself. So you got to have confidence. And a good teacher can teach anyone anything if you're willing to learn. I always say, I can't help you if you're not going to help yourself. So if you got that drive and you really want to learn, you really want to succeed, I love to see that. And you can tell, when someone comes in just excited and confident.
So we're looking for some confident questions from the group. So Jim, if it's all right with you, we'll stand up and go down here and make sure you can see folks. So I'll come to you with the mic for whoever has the first question. Virginia? I'm partial to the students first here. Your turn, we'll come. If you wouldn't mind standing, saying your name and asking the question.
Sure. My name is Nicole Martin, and I was reading over your core values, and obviously we've learned a lot of them in our MBA classes. I did have a question on number 15, which was focus on details. And I've taken a lot of, besides in grad school seminars, and oftentimes leaders say, don't focus on the details. Maybe make sure that you're delegating to someone that you trust, and so that you don't necessarily get bogged down.
What I mean by that is, nowadays we're in such a fast-paced environment, people don't really care if they do the job right the first time. They just want to get it off their desk or get it to the next level, and the job's not done right the first time. So people need to slow down a little bit, make sure the I's are dotted, the T's are crossed. If you're processing a customer order or whatever it is, make sure it's done the first time. But I'm sure we all get it. You get emails, and I just look at it sometimes, and I can tell the person hasn't even approved the email. I instead of it, or this or that. You see like 10 mistakes, and you're talking about hiring someone. You read an email, and they didn't even proof it, and I'm not the best in grammar, but there's obvious things that people don't even read their email. What does it take to read 3-4 sentences on an email? So the attention to detail, making sure you do it right the first time. Because in business, when you do something a second, a third, a fourth time, that's not good. So that's what I mean by pay attention to detail. Do it right the first time.
So, we value curiosity. And Jim also said, perhaps we can value another way. So thanks for the question. Could you tell them what this is?
$11 gift certificate, Legends of the Field. That's one of the companies I own now. So there's Mequon, Greenfield, and Delfield sports memorabilia store. Go in and spend $11.
Any other questions?
That's $11 since it's the 11-year anniversary.
So what other questions the folks have?
Rich Kopitz, good talk, Jim. Thank you.
Thank you.
When you ran world-class wire and cable, what was the key differentiator? What was the one characteristic trait attribute that you emphasized to put yourself in that world-class position that not only captured customers but kept them coming back?
When I touched on sharing the business plan, sharing financials with everyone, where everyone took ownership of that company. And we did simple things, you know, social hours, we wore t-shirts together, we had fun together, we made it a lot of fun. But everyone was able to speak up. What made it really successful, that one, there was 26 awards, it was getting sickening. At the last year we won like 13 awards in 1 year. It was kind of almost embarrassing. But the three things that stood out, one was sales growth. There was a chart that showed the sales. We went up in every single year in double digits. Number two, in hiring employees. What's the big thing right now? How many employees are you hiring? You know, every article you read in the paper, this company's hiring 50, this people 10. Well, we hired people every single year, double digit growth. The key was always hitting that double digit growth. And all my people bought into that. And then the third part, which we touched on, is getting involved with the community. And I found the sales growth, employee growth, and getting involved in the community made us noticeable to everyone. And in this case, the company that bought my company was a world company. And people were calling and bidding on it and so forth, and it got out of control. So once we got out there, volunteering in the community, tremendous sales growth and all that, word spread this company today. And I always say no one person knows everything. But think of it, in this room, if all the heads were together, how much we know. So when I got every single employee to buy into the company, and I shared that in bonuses and the fitness center and better benefit plans, and they saw that it worked. Once they started, oh my God, I got a Christmas bonus. And then we went to quarterly bonuses, and then we went to monthly bonuses. And it's all started happening because I always say it's incredible what a small group of people can accomplish when you're working together. And I got it to those employees would run through the wall for me because they believed in me, they believed in the company, they believed in the concept. And they saw that the harder they worked, the more money they got back. So it got really contagious, like the train that's moving slowly and then starts moving faster. Every employee really bought into it. It took some time to develop that, but once it happened, it really worked. Thank you. You get $11. Oh, you got it.
Okay, well, Jim, thank you for me. Number 23, learn how to learn and keep learning. I want you to stress on that one a little bit. And the reason I'm asking about that, because you know we all know that education, knowledge itself can become, let's say, expire after a certain point in time. So even for a business owner, so tell me about that one a little bit. Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Garfield Plunkett. I'm a graduate of this institution, class of 2009 MBA.
Learning, it's kind of a harsh statement, but if you're not learning, I say you're dying. And by learning, it can be done many, many different ways. Everyone here today, you're learning. Talking earlier, we had a couple meetings, we were all learning. You read a book, you learn. You volunteer in the community, you learn. So you're always learning, you're striving for more information. And so if you think about it, you're always learning. You're never done learning. And you have to keep learning. So it can be done by many, many different ways. And asking questions, you know, we had a great meeting with some of the students today, and they're asking questions, and people are expressing stuff, and everyone's learning together. So there's many ways of learning, but you gotta keep learning, constantly learning.
Hi, I'm Jake. Who do you learn from? Who are your mentors? And do you have any books or resources you would recommend to us, whether they're business related or otherwise?
Yeah, you know, books, there's constantly good, good books coming out. I played football at Whitewater, so I tend to be more into sports. I coached youth sports for 16 years. So I tend to go by a lot of coaches. I use a lot of sports analogies, but there's a lot of good people, you know, throughout the community. And you know, a lot of times, Biz Times will cite different books to read and so forth. And really, every year there's new books coming out. So I can't say there's one person or, you know, one book or anything like that. But there's just tons of good ones. And I just encourage you, just ask what the latest and greatest is. Find something that you kind of like, something maybe you want to develop an expertise in. But there's a lot of good things that you can read out there.
Barb Loberg, and I'm a graduate of Stritch. My question it sort of revolves around bonuses, et cetera. And that's a good plan. I'm sure the workers feel very good about it. There was a fellow just recently, and I can't think of the name of the company, but he cut his salary so that the workers could get, I think it was $70,000 or $40,000 each. What do you think about something like that? Would you do that?
Oh yeah, by all means. The first year when I started my company, I didn't pay myself the whole first year so that my employees could be paid. And we were fortunate, we didn't have bad years. But when it came to cutting, I always took the first cuts when we needed to. Sometimes there were times you had to cut, but by all means, and I think we all know it's gotten a little crazy sometimes, the big bonuses given to some of the big corporate people. So it's you all got to share into it. That's why I purposely shared the financials every month with everyone, so we knew what we were up against, you know. And a lot of times my people would volunteer, hey, I'll, you know, whatever it was, I'll help with this, or I'll do this, or reduce my overtime or whatever, you know. So it's a team effort. Everyone has to, you know, help each other and make sacrifices at time.
We're going to go to this corner.
Ms. Luckett. So as we can see the success of the small businesses and business you own, but what were the struggles? How do you get from the concept to the business plan to actually being successful?
Well, anyone that starts a new business or has started a new business, you know, we talk about revenue must exceed overhead. So we all watch the shows and you see Donald Trump and you see all the great success and it's like, oh, this is easy. Well, anyone that owned a business or who's going to own a business, you know, you have many sleepless nights where you go to bed, how am I going to pay that bill? And, you know, people are calling you and how do you pay the employees? And so, you know, we don't talk about the different statistics where 70-80% of businesses fail the first year or two. It's not easy. You know, when it works, it's great. But you got to be prepared for a lot of sacrifices. And whatever you think it takes to start a business as far as money, you better have 1.5 or twice that put aside, because no matter how good you budget, and it's never going to be exactly the way. So there are a lot of sacrifices. The other thing is the long hours. You have to, especially when it's your business and you're the one that has to pay the bills, you know, you better be prepared to work 50, 60, 70 hours a week, whatever it takes to make that order, to make that delivery, to keep that customer happy, you know. So there's a lot of pressure. It's fun when it works, but no one understands all the issues, employee issues and government paperwork and taxes and all the different things that you have to go through to run a business. So there is a lot of stress in it.
Hi Jim, my name is Antonio. I just wanted the free $11. out of all your achievements, what one meant the most to you?
Yeah, that's kind of tough too, because there was, you know, a lot of them listed up there, but more the community ones, you know, more. And I should say with World Class Wire and Cable, it was more the team efforts, you know, when the company won something and I could buy two or three tables and we were all cheering and clapping. And so it was the team awards that World Class Wire and Cable won. And then the community ones where you're helping in the community. And one sports related, again, too, I was president of Duval West Youth Football for 8 years. and he got me a big, big trophy, and we did really well. And it was from the kids to have 100 little youth kids coming up, and they're all wearing their jerseys, and to hand you a trophy for helping out for so many years, that was really neat, you know, because little kids are neat.
Hi, my name is Eduardo Diaz, and I just want to ask if you've ever considered establishing a professional soccer team in Milwaukee.
Yeah, so the update on soccer, again, we touched on it. I owned the Wave for 4 years, indoor professional soccer. Other people have tried an outdoor soccer team in Milwaukee. It's been a while. And the last time, I think it was about 10, 12 years ago. And it only lasted a year or two. It was pretty expensive. But they came out of the chute, and they weren't really prepared. I think it can work in Milwaukee. I personally won't be involved. I did my 4 years in a professional team. We were talking earlier, Coach Tozer, who coached the team here for 21 years, he's bringing futsal, he's trying to bring futsal, and he's the commissioner of the world in futsal, small, you know, smaller soccer for those that don't, 5 against 5. And so you're going to be hearing more about that. And but you'll some. There was an article the other day that someone's starting an outdoor soccer team on a smaller scale. So you're going to see it come back again.
Thank you. Eduardo's looking for investors, but it seems like you have to hold on. Yeah. Someone new? Yeah? We'll come back.
Hi, I'm Lisa. I'm in business ethics right now, and I was just wondering what kind of business ethics communication and training programs you have instilled in your company.
Well, some of them are listed on the core values, but, you know, being honest. When you're not honest, you usually get caught in your lies all the time. So being honest. Also, again, I mentioned all of you are in sales to some degree. When you overpromise and then you don't deliver, it's just bad. So when you tell someone you're going to do something, follow through and make it happen. I mean, those that call a salesperson and someone says, you'll see your couch next week, and it's 3 weeks instead of 1 week. You know, it's just people get themselves in trouble because they, I hate to use the word lie, but they, you know, they just, they're not accurate with their information. So I always tell them, I want to be really honest and take care of the customer as if, you know, it's yourself. How would you like to be treated? You know, be friendly to people, be positive, be upbeat, tell the truth, but just normal stuff.
Hi, my name is Arani Curry. I just have a question. When I start my business, how can I get in touch with you for a consultation?
You can look up Lindy Enterprises. That's my consulting business. My email address is on there.
So I want to follow up on her question. So who else should, she, when she starts her business, imminently?
Yeah, well, there's this thing.
Who else is in addition, oh, sorry, in addition to yourself? You were telling me there's three important people she might want to meet early on. I think one was a banker. Who, could you speak to that?
Yeah, usually if you know an attorney, a banker, an accountant, you know, those three people give you each experience which can help you get going. Make sure they don't charge you, you know, but try to get some free advice. And then some of you may have heard they invented this thing called Google. If you Google, you get all kinds of information. But it's tremendous. The Google, you know, you can look up anything you want, and every person you want. And, so I stress that too.
We have time for just a couple more. Someone over here.
Hi, my name is Aisha. I'm an alumni from 2011 MBA. You mentioned earlier how you was going to come back to Milwaukee and help and like give back. How do you assess the needs in the city of Milwaukee where the most help is needed and to help businesses or nonprofit organization or whatever to give back or to help and assist in any way?
Well, I try not to focus on one because there's so many good ones, and I like to just move around and helping different organizations, but my emphasis tends to be, again, in the youth. I love working with kids to whatever degree it is. So I work with Boys and Girls Club a lot. I work with the Journey House a lot. Sharp literacy, I believe reading is so important for kids to read. You learn so much when you read, so I like that. So there's tons of great organizations out there, but I tend to like them when it's youth.
We have time for one last question. She wants one more.
Nicole, again, so you have a great resume and you've clearly done a ton. Is there something, you said learn from failures, is there a failure or a foible or something like a hiccup that you remember, that you hold on to, that taught you the most, that you can share with us?
Well, on a personal level, one I've learned, because I became such a workaholic, you know, sometimes you neglect the ones in your life. So on a personal level, you gotta make sure that you're taking care of your significant other, your kids, whatever. You know, we get so focused and we work so much and kids grow up so quickly, you wanna make sure that you have that balance. And you gotta have fun in life. So on a personal level, that's one thing that stands out.
So, time for one last question. Did anyone else have something they'd like to finish up with, Jen? All right. And she doesn't get to ask a third question. So, with that, thanks very much, Gemma. We really appreciate the time and the interaction with her.
I'd just like to thank everyone for coming tonight. And whatever it is you're pursuing, best of luck, and it's great that you all came here today and you're all at Cardinal Stritch. So hopefully you learned something from the questions, and just best of luck to everyone in this room.